Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Stefano Bertozzi. I'm the Dean of the Public Health School, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you this evening for our Dean's Speaker Series talk tonight. I'm thrilled to be co-sponsoring this with co-sponsoring it with the School of Journalism, and David Teller is here representing the school, and in thanks to the sponsorship of Kaiser Permanente and Brian Raymond, who's here representing Kaiser and who's engineered this support, and we're very grateful for that because we're having a series of terrific talks. I'm not going to say anything about our speaker because that's what David's going to do, but I do want to remind those of you who are here that we have two talks coming up in March. One on the 15th of March, Ivan Oronsky is talking, and he's a really interesting health journalist, and I can't remember the name of the it's like Retraction Watch. I was going to say it's something bad, and I was going to come up with the name of it. Retraction Watch, exactly right. And the second is Sandro Galea, who's the dean at BU and a really interesting, thoughtful person. Very interesting guy to listen to speak. So I encourage you both to sign up for those talks. And now David is going to tell us about Dr. Angell, and I'm thrilled that you're here. Thank you.
Yeah, hi, thanks, Steph. I'm really delighted to have Marcia Angell here. When I was growing up, my dad was a doctor, so we always had stacks of New England Journal of Medicine and JAMA and The Lancet all around the house, not that I understood anything in them. So anyway, I am delighted to have Marcia here. She was the first woman to be editor-in-chief of New England Journal of Medicine after a number of years as an editor there. She's currently a professor at the School of Harvard Medical School in the Department of Global Health and Social Medicine, thank you, Global Health and Social Medicine. She's written a couple of really great books, Science on Trial, The Clash of Medical Evidence, and the Law in the Breast Implant Case, and also a book about the drug companies, which I've assigned a couple of her articles from the New York Review of Books, which I guess were the genesis maybe of that book, or sort of excerpts from that book. About the drug companies and how they kind of manipulate their studies and so on. And so I'm really delighted to have her here talking about a topic that we'll all be facing at some point, if we're not already facing it now. So thank you very much, Marcia.
Thank you, David. And Dean Bertozzi, do I have that right? And thank you. It's a great pleasure to have been invited to come to Berkeley and give this talk. I lived in Berkeley for 3 years, from 1969 until 1972. They were very intense and exciting years. So it's delightful to have the chance to come back at apparently a calmer time. I'm going to be talking today about dying in America. I think it was Woody Allen who said he wasn't afraid of dying. He just didn't want to be there when it happened. But he will be there when it happens, and so will all of us. So I think it's very important to give it a little thought before it comes to that time, and particularly because death has changed dramatically in the last half century. For millennia, death was pretty much the same all the time, but it started to change about a half century ago. For both good and for ill. And so I think it does behoove us to learn something about those changes. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today, the changes. Before World War II, most Americans died at home. And it wasn't exactly a medical event. It was more of an existential or family event. And we've all seen pictures of people dying in bed with their family arrayed around them and their close friends. It was just what happened at the end of life. Now, occasionally a doctor would be present, but he did more harm, and it was always a he, but he did more harm than good, usually. For example, George Washington probably had a bad cold, but he died because his doctor came and bled him to death. So for a doctor to show up was not a very good thing in general. The usual cause of a natural death was infection. Diphtheria in children, tuberculosis in young adults, pneumonia at all ages, whatever the underlying condition. Pneumonia usually would settle in toward the end, and when it did, a patient would die quickly within a couple of days and fairly peacefully. Now, all of that changed in the second half of the 20th century. And what I'm going to do today, as I said, is describe how it changed, the consequences of the changes, and the implications. There are three important dates I'll emphasize, so watch for them as they go by: 1976, 1990, and 1997. 1976, 1990, and 1997. And you will see why those three dates are important as I go along. The United States emerged from World War II with money and optimism to burn. And one of the places it poured its vast amounts of money and optimism was in medical science and technology. The NIH, the National Institutes of Health, grew very rapidly, as did the medical schools and teaching hospitals that the NIH supported. Within a matter of just a couple of decades, because of all the new drugs and technologies that poured out of the medical establishment, virtually no death was considered inevitable. Death was regarded as optional, almost. We now had a host of new antibiotics that could cure nearly any bacterial infection. And in particular, it could prevent deaths from pneumonia. Before that, pneumonia had been called, quote, the old man's friend, close quotes, because you could count on it, bringing about a fairly quick and peaceful death in patients who were at the end of their life for some other reason. In addition, by the 1970s, we also had dialysis to prevent death from kidney failure, artificial ventilators to do the work of breathing for us, new drugs to support blood pressure, methods of cardiopulmonary resuscitation to maintain heartbeat and heart function, effective artificial feeding, and so forth and so forth. As a result of all the new technologies, dying patients might live in intensive care units for weeks, hooked up to tubing, to four or five different support and monitoring devices, with antibiotics to suppress the bacteria that would in earlier days have entered the body through the tubes. In short, death became medicalized. No longer did people die at home in a matter of days, but in hospitals in a matter of weeks or months, often in great misery, not so much because of the illness, but because of the treatment. I was a medical student and resident in the 1960s. Dying was hardly mentioned in medical school or training programs except as a failure of treatment. We were told, do this or else the patient might die. But that was the only real mention of it. It was rarely spoken of to families, let alone patients, who were never to be denied hope for a recovery, no matter how unlikely that recovery was. Sometimes when patients were in obvious misery at the end of life, doctors would increase the dose of morphine with the expectation, with the hope, that it would hasten death. But they usually didn't consult with anyone about it. It was not mentioned. Even in those days, an order for a large dose of morphine could lead to trouble. And it was more a reflection of the doctor's compassion and courage and judgment than of the patient's needs and desires and wishes. There was beginning to be some attention to the issue of miserable protracted deaths in the 1950s and 1960s. For example, in 1957, Pope Pius XII said that, quote, extraordinary means of treatment was not required by the Catholic Church. But within the medical establishment, where deaths happened, there was virtually no recognition of that problem. Indeed, in those days, withdrawing life-sustaining medical treatment or artificial feeding would have been considered tantamount to euthanasia. It simply wasn't done. All of that began to change in 1976, your first date, as a result of a lawsuit filed by the father of a young woman named Karen Ann Quinlan. Those of you here of a certain age will remember her very well, I'm sure. This was the first and most celebrated right to die case in this country. Quinlan was a young woman who had suffered an accidental overdose of drugs. I don't know whether she was at a party or what, but anyway, she had too much. And she was found without respirations. She was resuscitated and hospitalized, but she never regained consciousness. She had what is called a permanent vegetative state, which means that all of the higher levels of her brain were no longer functioning, just the lower levels of her brain. When it became clear to her parents that the doctors confirmed this, that she would never wake up, that this was her permanent state, the parents asked to have the ventilator. She was on a ventilator and artificial feeding. They asked to have the ventilator removed. And of course, the hospital said, we can't do this. And the parents then went to court. It wended its way up to the New Jersey Supreme Court, and in a remarkable decision, the New Jersey Supreme Court said that the parents had the right to make the decision either way. They could remove the ventilator and or the feeding tube or not as they chose. The only condition was that what they call an ethics committee, and it was really a prognosis committee, but they called it an ethics committee, the court did, that they confirmed that this indeed was a prognosis, that she was in a permanent vegetative state and would never wake up. The parents then decided to take her off the ventilator. The expectation was that she would die. They would not remove the artificial feeding. They thought there was a difference. They were religious people, and they thought that the feeding was something different. So ironically, it turned out she hadn't required the ventilator, and she lived another 9 years with artificial feeding before she finally died. The Quinlan case launched a remarkable 14-year period between 1976 and 1990, in which the right to withhold or withdraw life-sustaining treatment became almost universally recognized throughout the country. And incidentally, no distinction was made between artificial feeding and other forms of life-sustaining treatment. The first move in this 14-year-old remarkable advance was in California. California is almost always first. And within months after Quinlan's death, California passed the first Natural Death Act in the United States, which essentially, within some limits, gave doctors immunity for following the directions, the directives in living wills, which is what advance directives were called then. And pretty promptly, every other state in the country followed suit and passed their own natural death acts. This 14-year move culminated in the U.S. Congress's Patient Self-Determination Act of 1990. And this act requires, it's still on the books, it currently requires all medical facilities that receive federal fundings, and that's almost all of them, that all medical facilities inform patients of their rights to refuse any treatment for any reason whatsoever, to prepare advance directives in case they can't, they're not capable of making a decision when the time comes, and to name a proxy to act for them. So this became the law of the land. And that's why one reason 1990 is my second important date in the evolution of how we die in America. That year also, in addition to seeing the passage of the Patient Self-Determination Act, saw the decision of an important Supreme Court case, the case of Nancy Cruzan, and that was in 1990. Nancy Cruzan was a patient very much like Karen Quinlan, a young woman who ended up in a permanent vegetative state, and her parents, too, asked to have the ventilator removed. They came from Missouri. They went to the Missouri Supreme Court that refused. Missouri was one of two states that had very tight regulations on this. It said that there had to be clear and convincing evidence left by any patient before life-sustaining treatment could be removed. The other states were much more liberal about this. And she had not left clear and convincing evidence. So the parents took the case up to the U.S. Supreme Court, which that year decided against the parents on the grounds that Missouri did have this peculiarly stringent requirement, but they were very sympathetic to the issue. And in that case, in their decision, while they ruled against the Cruzan family, they recognized explicitly the rights of patients to refuse life-sustaining treatment, either directly or through proxies. So the parents, hold on, I have to tell you what happened after that. So the issue then was that the parents couldn't prevail because there was not clear and convincing evidence. And within a microsecond, about a whole bunch of Nancy's friends came forward and said, why? She told us that she didn't want to live like Karen Quinlan. And so the court said, oh, okay. And so they removed the ventilator. So in a sense, all of this was sort of unnecessary. But they removed the ventilator, and she did die very shortly, unlike Quinlan, who managed to survive for 9 years without it. Okay, we're at 1990. So then what happened? There had always been a small movement that favored assisted suicide or euthanasia. Assisted suicide, for those who aren't following these sorts of definitions, involves the patient himself or herself taking it's usually an overdose of medication, doing the act to end his or her life. In euthanasia, the doctor administers an injection that does the same thing. So that is the distinction. And there had always been a movement that favored assisted suicide or euthanasia, but it had little impact. It was well outside the mainstream in general, and certainly within the medical establishment. It was disreputable. But the essential argument of this movement made sense. And what they said was, people can hasten an inevitable death by foregoing life-sustaining treatment, such as a ventilator or dialysis. But what about people who didn't have that kind of life-sustaining treatment that could be withdrawn? They said this discriminates against people who are suffering just as much, who also have a terminal illness, but for some reason don't have this thing that you can grab hold of and forego or withdraw. For example, somebody could have widespread cancer of the lung and not be able to breathe without an artificial ventilator even for a day. So that patient is on a technology that can be removed if the patient wants. The patient can say, stop with the ventilator, and that has to be done. Well, what about a patient who has widespread cancer of the pancreas, also with facing imminent death, but who doesn't happen to need a ventilator or antibiotics or dialysis? That patient can be suffering just as much, but has to endure a protracted death, even if he or she would rather end their life sooner. So what about them? It wasn't until early 1990s that this issue began to have traction. And that was because of the emergence of two influential proponents, essentially a bad cop and a good cop, whose activities captured the media and also the attention of the medical establishment and medical ethicists. The bad cop was Dr. Jack Kevorkian, a pathologist, who in 1990 set out on something of a crusade to help people who wanted to end their lives, sick people, ostensibly, who wanted to end their lives, to end their lives. He would set up a contraption, maybe an IV with an overdose of barbiturates, and then the patient had to trip the IV so that it actually started to flow. So Kevorkian didn't actually kill the patient. He just made it possible for the patient, easier for the patient, to end his own life. Or he also had a carbon monoxide contraption, I think, of another sort. According to his own lawyer, he had assisted in 44 suicides using these contraptions. But these were not his patients. He was not a clinician. He traveled all around the country. Many of them were virtual strangers to him. And he horrified a lot of people in the medical establishment. The interesting thing, though, is he did not horrify the public. The public was, by and large, fairly sympathetic. Michigan, he came from Michigan, and Michigan passed a law that was designed to stop him. It essentially said, Dr. Jack Kevorkian, if you help more people commit suicide, we will, you know, indict you for manslaughter or something. So they created a law for the purpose. And four times, Kevorkian was brought before a grand jury, and four times they refused to indict. So there was quite a bit of sympathy, right up to the point where he committed euthanasia on television. He actually administered the injection. And then he was arrested, and I think he died in prison. So he was the bad cop, although, as I said, the public had a lot of sympathy for what he was trying to do. The good cop was Dr. Timothy Quill, who is an internist in Rochester, New York. In 1991, he told the compelling story of his decision to provide a patient whom he called Diane with a prescription for an overdose of sleeping pills to end her life if and when she chose. Diane had been his patient for 8 years. She had leukemia. The only chance, she was in her middle 40s, she had a husband, a grown son. Her only chance of a cure was a bone marrow transplantation, and that was unlikely to work, and of course, very risky, and she decided not to have that. So she asked Dr. Quill whether he would be willing to give her a prescription. He wasn't going to be there, but she would take it if and when she chose. The point came, she lived for quite some time, but the point came when she felt it was time. She asked her husband and son to take a long walk. They did. They came back an hour later, and she had taken the medication, and she was dead. Quill told this story in an article that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. Like Quinlan, Kevorkian became a household name, and Quill, even though he did not become a household name, became very well known within the medical profession, which was basically sympathetic to him, not to Kevorkian, but to Quill. At the time that Quill wrote his article, 36 states had laws against assisted suicide by anyone, doctor, friend, anyone. And New York was one of those states. Quill submitted this article about Diane to the New England Journal of Medicine in 1991. I was at that time, I think it was 1991, I was at that time executive editor. And I remember reading the manuscript as soon as it came in. I think it was on a Friday. And I thought it was a very good manuscript, and I wanted to publish it. But I phoned him up, and I said, you realize you're taking a risk. You live in New York. It's illegal there. You really ought to think hard about publishing this piece. And, you know, I'm with you, whatever decision you want to make. And he, at that time, he didn't know all of this. He certainly knows it now. And I said, take a few days and talk to the hospital attorney and talk to your own attorney, your wife, decide what you want to do, and let me know. I think it must have been Tuesday, just a few days later, that he phoned me back and he said, I found out everything I have to know and I want to go ahead. So we published Quill's article. Almost immediately, the county DA brought Quill before a grand jury to indict him for manslaughter. After a harrowing 3 months, the grand jury, just like the Kevorkian grand juries, refused to indict him. And he turned right around and sued the state of New York to overturn the law as a violation of the 14th Amendment. And he's since then become a very well-known national spokesman for assisted suicide as a last resort in taking care of dying patients. So he sued New York. In 1996, appeals courts found laws against assisted suicide in New York, this was the Quill case, and also in Washington state to be unconstitutional, because they were violations of the 14th Amendment, different parts of the 14th Amendment, but they were unconstitutional. Both of these appeals court decisions, it was the second appeals court in New York and the Ninth Circuit here, both of these cases wended their way toward the U.S. Supreme Court. Meanwhile, a few years earlier, to almost everyone's surprise, the voters in Oregon passed a Death with Dignity Act by a voter referendum, narrowly passed it. And this would permit physician-assisted suicide under certain stringently limited conditions. And this, too, then wended its way toward the Supreme Court. It was not implemented. The Bush administration did everything it could to stop it by invoking the Controlled Substances Act. It said, okay, if doctors do this, they are using controlled substances for things that they're not approved for, and they can lose their license. So doctors were very, you know, scared by this, and as well they might be. And nothing happened, even though this law was passed, until 1997 when they did a do-over, and I'll come back to that in a minute. But all of this legal activity came to a head in 1997, the third date I wanted you to remember. And the U.S. Supreme Court then heard the Quill case from New York and the Washington case, and it reversed the appeals courts. That is, it said there was no constitutional right to physician-assisted suicide. So they overturned the appeals courts. But the spirit of this decision was very, very sympathetic to the people who favored a right to die or assisted suicide. O'Connor, Justice O'Connor in particular, but the others too, said, look, this is a medical matter. And it's a matter for the states. The states usually decide medical matters. And the states could do whatever they wanted. It was left to the laboratory of the states, as they say. So then there was this do-over. This was 1997. And there was this do-over in Oregon. They had another referendum. And this time it passed overwhelmingly. So it came into effect in 1998, the first state to legalize assisted suicide, and they have now had 18 years of experience with it. So what is in Oregon's Death with Dignity Act? Well, essentially it says that a competent adult, that is adult capable of understanding and making a decision, who is terminally ill, that is, two doctors certify that the patient has no more than six, likely, nobody can know for sure, but likely no more than 6 months to live, that and who finds life unbearable, that such a patient can request a prescription of an overdose of barbiturates, it's usually barbiturates, to end their life sooner. They have to make two oral requests 15 days apart and one written request with two witnesses. If anyone involved thinks that a mental disorder is affecting their judgment, is impairing their judgment, then they have to be referred to a mental health counselor. But note, impairing their judgment. It does not include being depressed, as many terminally ill patients are, as long as it does not impair your judgment. The Oregon Department of Health keeps careful records, and they now have records of 18 years, full years, during which this law seems to have worked just about exactly as intended. There have been no well-documented cases of abuses of any sort. As of the end of 2015, there were, I think, a little bit less than 1,000 deaths from this law over the 18 years, so not very many. It accounts for only 1 in 200 deaths, or 0.5% in Oregon. There's been a slight increase over the years, as one might expect. For one thing, it's solidly legal now. You didn't have to worry about the Controlled Substances Act, and people have more experience with it. So it's going up, but slowly. Last year, I think 218 terminally ill people in Oregon availed themselves of this law, but only 132 of those 218 actually took the medication. Throughout the 18 years, a full third of everyone who gets the medication does not take it, but leaves it on the bedside table for peace of mind. That's essentially how it's used for a third of the patients. Most of these patients had cancer, metastatic cancer. The diagnosis was never in doubt, had widespread metastatic cancer. The minority had amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, end-stage lung disease, heart failure, but most had widespread cancer. The great majority were receiving hospice care at that time. So they had already gone the palliative care and hospice care route. And the reasons they gave for wanting to end their life sooner, the primary reason was not pain, which we usually think it would be. And pain is relatively easy to treat. Other symptoms of terminal illness are much harder to treat. breathlessness, nausea, weakness, loss of bodily functions. These things are much more difficult to deal with. And also just the existential suffering of knowing that tomorrow is likely to be even worse than today. And things just keep getting worse until finally you die. I think that causes a great deal of suffering too. What they said was their reason was inability to engage in meaningful life activities anymore, loss of autonomy, and loss of dignity. And pain was further down the list in the reasons that they gave. Now, at first, there was a lot of fear that if you allowed this, if this became legal, people would be pressured to use it because they didn't want to cost their family money. They were poor. They didn't have insurance. They were in some way vulnerable, and that was the original fear. But in fact, those fears were not borne out. On average, the Oregonians who use this law are better educated than the average, and they are well insured. So this was not a law, particularly at first, that was used by vulnerable people, but almost the opposite. People who were used to having some control over their lives and wanted control now over their death. There was also the concern that this would come to supplant palliative care. But in fact, what you saw was a competition. The palliative care community said, we can handle this. And I welcome that competition. I hope they win. The palliative care improved a lot in Oregon. There's an organization called the Center to Advance Palliative Care, and they come out with grades, with ratings for states every few years. And I recently checked the 2011 rating for the states. I think it goes A through D. And Oregon's rating was A, and my own state of Massachusetts, its rating was B. So Oregon is doing very well in palliative care. Washington State then enacted the same law in 2008, again by a voter referendum, and so far the experience has been much the same in these two states. Then two states approached this through the courts, not through a voter referendum. One was Montana. The Supreme Court in Montana said, this isn't our business. This is a medical matter. Leave that to the doctors. It had a sort of libertarian cast, as you might expect, in Montana. And I don't know whether they have regulated it or not. I haven't kept up with that. But Montana then legalized it in this way. New Mexico is in the middle of it. One of its lower courts has pronounced it legal, and it's now before the New Mexico Supreme Court, which is expected to hand down a decision any day. So this is the courts. Now we have two states that legalized it through the state legislature. One is Vermont, a couple of years ago, that legalized it with the same regulations as Oregon and Washington. And now, as you all know, California. California is the most recent. It has not been implemented and may not be implemented for another year, but it could be implemented 3 months from now. It will be implemented for sure within a year. So we now have 5.5 states in which assisted suicide is now legal. Now, a word about the terminology. I've been saying assisted suicide because you will know what I mean. There were many in the community that favor legalizing assisted suicide who objected to that term. And what they said is that this can confuse this situation with what happens when an otherwise healthy person, because of depression, chooses death over life. And their argument was that these people are not choosing death over life. They would love to be able to choose life over death, but they are going to die. and going to die within 6 months. So all they're doing is choosing the precise timing and manner of death, not death over life. And so the new terminology, which I'm sure you'll hear, I'm sure you heard in the California's effort to repeal the law, the new terminology is aid in dying, physician-assisted dying, something that gets the word suicide out of it. I have a little problem with this because it makes it hard to distinguish between assisted suicide and euthanasia, both of which are assisted dying. But nevertheless, that is the preferred term and the term that I usually use, assisted dying. So note that these laws apply only to physician-assisted suicide, not to euthanasia. Euthanasia is illegal in all states in the United States. Switzerland is the same. Assisted suicide is legal, but not euthanasia. But in the Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg, they make no distinction. It's the same thing. And in fact, they practice euthanasia more than assisted suicide simply because it's faster and easier and you don't have to swallow a lot of pills. Now, a year ago, Canada, by a unanimous decision in its Supreme Court in Ottawa, approved assisted dying throughout Canada. This came from a case before the Supreme Court in British Columbia a few years before. And it wended its way up to Ottawa. And in a 9-0 decision about a year ago, the Canadian Supreme Court approved assisted dying in the whole country. In British Columbia, in that original case, no distinction was made between euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide, nor did the patient have to be terminally ill. They simply had to be suffering from an irreversible illness that could not be relieved. So much broader than any of the states in this country. Now, the provinces still have to write the regulations, and they might narrow it somewhat. There's a year before it can be implemented, and this is what's going on now. But I suspect when it starts to be practiced in Canada widely that this will have quite a bit of influence in this country, particularly on the border states. And my own perception is that what will happen then, and what is happening now, is something parallel to what happened with same-sex marriage. You know, it was considered just out of bounds when it was first approved in Massachusetts. A lot of resistance. Then other states started to do it, and the sky did not fall in. And now just about everywhere in this country, same-sex marriage is regarded as kind of a ho-hum. I would expect that what we'll see with physician-assisted dying is something like that, something that seems so odd when it first began in Oregon, will spread broadly and be considered just a part of good medical practice, a reluctant part, as Quill said, but nevertheless a part. Full disclosure. I was the first of the 14 original petitioners to put this on the ballot in Massachusetts. It was narrowly defeated in 2012. I suspect if it were on the ballot next year, which it can't be, or this year, which it can't be, because you have to wait a certain period of time before the same initiative can be on the ballot. But I suspect if it were on the ballot, it would pass. It was a very, very close call in 2012. And I spent a lot of time studying the issue, speaking about the issue, and working hard to get it passed. And here are my reasons. First, as I said earlier, this is about the manner of death. It is not about life versus death. It's the manner and the precise timing of an inevitable death. And not all suffering can be relieved. I think a lot of people in the palliative care and hospice community want to give that impression. Because like everyone, they're proud of what they do and what they can do. But as I mentioned, almost everybody in Oregon was receiving palliative care. It wasn't that this was a choice they made, we'll do assisted dying instead of palliative care. So not all suffering can be relieved. In the States, where it's legal, in all parts of the world, this is a choice for both doctors and patients. No one has to do this. The AMA, which has officially opposed this, and the Massachusetts Medical Society opposed it in Massachusetts, they often focus on the doctors. They say this is not what doctors should be doing, that the Hippocratic Oath requires them to extend life, not to take part in shortening life. It just isn't what doctors should be doing. This argument always kind of irritated me because it shifts the focus from the patient to the doctor. It's all about the doctor and what he's supposed to do and not about what the patient feels and wants. My view is that, yes, doctors should be prolonging life when they can, but when they can't, that is, when there is a terminal illness that will end life within the half a year, their overriding duty shifts from prolonging life to relieving suffering and doing so in accord with the patient's wishes. It's the patient who matters. I also have always thought that there's something a little bit almost like piling on when you say to a patient, you may not end your life sooner and more peacefully. It's a little bullying, and these patients have problems enough without having other people come in and tell them what's good for them and what isn't good for them. No one should presume to tell someone else how much suffering they can endure. Atul Gawande, in his book, Being Mortal, Medicine and What Matters in the End, talks about the modern technological imperative to prolong life, to just keep on flogging the patient. He said, quote, "We imagine that we can wait until the doctors tell us that there's nothing more we can do. But rarely is there nothing more that doctors can do. They can give toxic drugs of unknown efficacy, operate to try to remove a part of the tumor, put in a feeding tube. If a person can't eat, there is always something." Close quotes. I sometimes think of these lines from a poem by Algernon Swinburne. It's called The Garden of Proserpine. And what he said in this poem was, quote, "We thank with brief thanksgiving, whatever gods may be, that no man lives forever, that dead men rise up never, that even the weariest river winds somewhere safe to see." Close quotes. Now, maybe that's a little bleak, but still, we owe it to one another to recognize that we must all die, even Woody Allen. It's both mindless and heartless to try to stave it off indefinitely, no matter the cost in suffering, just because we have the technology to do so. Thank you, and I'll take any questions and discussion.
Thank you so much. That was incredibly thoughtful and took me right back. I came of age medically at the height of the AIDS epidemic in San Francisco.
Yes.
And I, when I stopped practicing medicine, used to often say that I never did anything that had more meaning than helping somebody die well. And hopefully somebody will do that for me someday. So, open for questions. Please do me a favor and identify yourselves when you speak.
Stefan Paul Hoffman, and I talked to Marcia just briefly, informally before her superb presentation, and she encouraged me to ask her to elaborate a little bit about her views relative to the value of advanced directives. So I just want to take this opportunity, given that I suspect most people in the room are familiar with the topic and what we can and should do to encourage more members of our society to complete advanced directives.
Obviously, I think that's very important, or I wouldn't have planted him. We all should have advanced directives. And I think a lot of people think, well, you know, we'll put this off. But it's terribly important to have them. But it's also important what is in them and what is not in them. And there's been a recent move to make them ever more detailed. They go on and on and on about hypothetical situations that you may or may not face, and would you want dialysis but not antibiotics if you had this or you had that. It's like any other industry. It tends to expand. And so these directives become hard to fill out, hard to live with, and not very practical. So my recommendation is, if you have someone who loves you and whom you love and whom you trust, usually grown children, spouse, that you simply name that person as a proxy with no restrictions. And that is what I've done with my own advanced directives. I've named my daughter, and I've said, no restrictions. She can make whatever decisions she wants that are consistent with what I would legally be able to do if I were mentally aware. I have sent her a personal letter that says, as you know, the length of my life is far less important to me than the quality of my life. You know how I feel. Love, Mom. But all it has is her name and no restrictions. Many people don't have such a person, and their life is much more difficult for many reasons. But that's, if you do have such a person, that's what I would recommend.
In the back, then here, sorry.
I'm Shauna Newland. I used to teach a course here with Dick Stroman and Walter Bortz, who had a lot to say about this. But in Belgium, as I understand it, last year, there was a case of a 24-year-old mm-hmm. who petitioned to be euthanized and petitioned successfully to be euthanized. And mm-hmm. I don't have an answer to this, but where do we draw the line? There was nothing actually medically wrong with this person mm-hmm. beyond depression. And yeah. I'm just wondering, where can the yeah. line be drawn?
Yeah, I think that's difficult. I think there have been such cases in the Netherlands, too, where somebody had been treated for depression over and over again, and the depression was just so heavy that was considered, you don't have to be terminally ill. That was considered an illness that would qualify them for euthanasia. It's not going to cause death within 6 months. And so far, the laws in this country require that. And I would be inclined to keep it at that for now.
I guess I'm up. Yes, I'm right here. Right. Hello. There,
please. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm Michael Stein. I'm a retired neurologist. But one of the questions I have about this throughout the United States, you're talking about going from state to state, is the inevitable effect of religion and its various points mm-hmm. of view on this. I mean, mm-hmm. one thinks of the Deep South or whatever as though, mm-hmm. you know, evangelicals and so on will never allow this. Mormons, I would mm-hmm. wonder, but I don't mm-hmm. know, would never allow this. Catholics and so on, yeah. Jews. How does that fit into all of this?
Well, as Woody Allen intimated, we all die. And I see a real gap between ordinary religious people and the hierarchy of their church. As you know, Catholics are very powerful and very numerous in Massachusetts. And yet all the polls, right up until the last few days, showed that there was no distinction between Catholics and non-religious people or Protestants. They tended to favor it overwhelmingly because everyone has seen a bad death, or almost everyone has seen a bad death. And in a way, it was a little bit like birth control. Catholics aren't supposed to use that, but they use it in Massachusetts as much as anyone else does. So there's a schism between the hierarchy of the churches and ordinary people, I think. As far as the South goes, I think if there were a lot of experience in the northern states and in Canada, because they too die, I think you would see the movement there too, even though the churches themselves are stronger in the South. We'll see.
I'm Amy Garland. I'm a physician at the East Bay AIDS Center and a medical educator at the Berkeley UCSF Joint Medical Program. I'm sorry to have to admit what a poor job I think we clinicians often do with informed consent in general. And with a procedure such as this, it seems as important as ever, because obviously it's irreversible. I'm grateful to the upswelling of journalistic and other accounts in the media of people's experience with dying. It's really, there's been just such a tremendous upswing in the prevalence of those stories accessible to people. And I think that that is a great boon for people's understanding right. of this process. Obviously, none of us can tell anyone much about death until we're there ourselves, but there's a lot we can share, I think, about experience with the dying process. In addition to those kinds of stories, I'm wondering what you think are the most important bits of information for a patient to have for there to be as informed as possible consent around making this decision.
You mean in states where it's legal?
Indeed.
Yeah. You know, I haven't thought about that question because it seems to me that of all people, dying patients will have thought of just about everything. I think there is a very strong instinct to live life, to keep living it, to prolong it. So even people dying protracted, awful deaths, still want to keep fighting, still want to keep fighting. The people, I mentioned just 0.5% in Oregon who say, I can't soldier on, I can't do it anymore, are really a small percentage. I guess what I would want them to know is that it's okay, that they're not doing something cowardly, that they don't have to feel that they're taking an easy way out or that they are being less than dignified. I think they're being very dignified. And I think giving them permission is probably the best thing that those of us not experiencing that can do. Yes, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, I'm Jessica Zitter. I work at Highland Hospital. I'm one of the palliative care doctors who you mm-hmm. refer to, and also an ICU doctor. And I agree with you. I think there are situations that I've seen where there really is a tremendous amount of suffering, and we just can't get our arms around it. It's very, very rare, but I think it exists. And I certainly would want to have, for myself and for my mother and for whoever else I know, to have that option available. My concern comes in working in the county hospital with the fact that there really are a lot of patients that I have, and it's not a small number, who cannot afford to stay home with hospice. They don't have the money for their family members can't take time off of work. And so I've seen several situations and it's a real concern to me mm-hmm, about mm-hmm. those patients and how they're going to not feel like a burden on their families and using that as an out.
Yes. Well, you've raised a different subject and a terrible subject, the problem with healthcare in this country. and that it's a function of how much money you have or how much insurance your money will buy. And that would be another talk.
To that as my prerogative, and then I'll pass it on. Is there a misalignment between the things that people might want in their advanced directives and the incentives in the healthcare system that they may want to die at home in hospice, but the healthcare system will force them into a hospital for an invasive thing? I mean, is there a misalignment with what people might want and what the healthcare system with our insurance system will actually provide them with at the end of life?
I think there's a little bit of misalignment in that usual hospice care at home does not include intravenous access. So there's some limitations that are not necessary, but are still there. But nobody can force someone to go to the hospital. And that's where the family and the proxy are important. If the patient says no, the answer is no. But I think things could be set up in the home that would make it easier.
Hi, Chris Canavy, clinic.
It's good.
It's on? It's on? Okay, clinical nurse specialist. One thing that I don't agree with you on is that I know that you don't like I don't like the word assisted suicide. Mm-hmm. I personally feel that if someone is within 6 months of quote unquote their inevitable death, mm-hmm. the word suicide is still so stigmatized in this country.
Yeah.
So I really do like the word of assistance with dying, inevitable dying, because suicide really is very, very hard for families and the person themselves. So that's just one of my questions. And then the other point is what I'm just finding is that now with technology, and I don't mean the big technology with, being kept on a ventilator. I'm talking about now I've had a couple of instances recently in my own family circle where 90-something-year-old women are being offered cardiac surgery because they can now do it less invasively. And so it's not, it's being approached like it's typical and it's, we have good results.
Yes.
And
well, that's what Atul Gawande was saying, that there's a technological imperative and you keep going. As far as the word suicide goes, usually I do say assisted dying. Today, partly because I wanted to make a distinction with euthanasia, I did not. I should say, though, I have never felt that suicide deserved to be stigmatized. I have a great deal of sympathy for people who do that, and I've never thought of it as a bad thing to have done.
I'm Dan Wooden, physician from Bath, Maine. I was thinking a little bit about Alzheimer's disease, which is a scourge, which most of my friends who talk about it say, "Gee, I just hope you'll do something about it when."
That's right.
When I am so involved. And I wonder what your thoughts are, Marcia.
Yeah.
Same question.
The states where it's legal would prohibit it being used for people with Alzheimer's because you have to be an adult and you have to be mentally competent at that time. You cannot do it through advanced directives. This was all a part of the effort to get it passed by making it very, very narrow. And people with ALS, for example, who could live for 2 years and not 6 months, people with Alzheimer's just can't take advantage of it. I hope that, when you regulate something, you don't want to regulate it out of existence. I mean, that's what's happening with abortion now throughout the country. States are regulating it out of existence to some extent. If you say something is legal and permissible, yes, it's okay to regulate it, but within limits. And I hope that as we have experience with assisted dying in this country, that people will feel more comfortable, less worried about abuses, to open it up to certain other situations. And one would be Alzheimer's with advanced directives. So that somebody who has early Alzheimer's, who might live a perfectly okay life for 5 years, doesn't feel that he or she has to end their life then, but knows that 5 years down the road, when they no longer recognize their family members, they can be given a comfortable death. And that would mean euthanasia.
My name is Suzanne Summer, and I'm a physician in emergency medicine and palliative care. And one thing I wonder, and you describe it happening in the Oregon situation, that this is becoming an option that's really for the white, middle and upper class, well-educated people. And just, you know, as my coworker brought up, there is always the possibility that we are more reluctant to offer this to people who are not like ourselves, because they may have motives that are more economic, or we don't understand the motives. And I'm reminded of a chaplain I work with who does advance directives with poor communities, and says that he has a lot of people who choose, for instance, to donate their body to science because their family can't afford burial. I struggle ethically, I think, with this whole issue, because I do think it is kind of restricted to these certain groups. And what is your thought on that?
Yeah, it's a very good point. And I think in practice it is somewhat restricted. It isn't that anybody sets out to restrict it, but these are the people who have thought about it, who know about it, who've read about it, and show up. Doctors in the states where it's legal, they don't go around and sell it. Somebody has to raise the subject. And I don't know of a good answer. It's a little bit like the other question. You're talking about a system that permits great inequality in every possible way, including medicine. I think that doctors, I hope, will become more attuned to this. You know, I think there was such a fear that it would be pressured on poor people, that there's a leaning over backwards now, and so it's only offered. But, you know, at first it was offered mainly to white men. You know, the executives, and now it's men and women equally, but still upper class, relatively upper class.
Hi, my name is Anne, and I'm one of those hospice social workers. Uh-huh. And a couple of things. One is, I wonder if we had a healthcare system that did not have a financial incentive in prolonging death, never mind prolonging life, whether this wouldn't be such a big issue, whether it would be taken for granted that it was part of someone's lifelong healthcare that they died without suffering. And so I think the financial incentive to keep people ticking really works against that. And the other part is, in my experience as a social worker with hospice, I've had very few people actually want an assistance in making their death come quicker. And of the few people who did want to talk about it, the majority really wanted someone to sit there and say, I know you want to die soon, and that's just fine. And they wanted the opening of that conversation about how hard it was that they hadn't died yet. And when they had someone who didn't say, don't worry, dear, it's going to be okay, the need to take something to hurry that death seemed to go away.
Yeah. I suspect you're very good at what you do. I was talking to a gentleman in the audience at the beginning about the financial incentives. I am very attuned to financial incentives in medicine, conflicts of interest of all sorts. I think this is one area where it does not play much of a role, if any. I think when doctors keep subjecting dying patients to one more treatment, as Atul Gawande says, you know, one more thing to try, one more chemotherapy. It isn't because they're trying to make money for the hospital or for themselves. It's because of this technological imperative that so much of the culture of medicine. And also, it's because to tell the patient the truth, it creates an emotional scene. And doctors don't want emotional scenes. So if you say, well, we'll give you one more thing, one more technological thing, they can skitter away from a possible emotional scene.
We're going to have to move to the reception, but I'm going to take the privilege of asking you one. Mm-hmm. Full disclosure, I'm a past trustee of the AMA. Mm-hmm. I have physician friends.
You seem so nice.
I was a student. I have physician friends who keep an IV kit and a bag of potassium in their bedside table just because something might happen, and they might want to make sure that they can take care of the problem should it arise. And so I find there to be an extraordinary irony that the very people for whom that control is the most important would deny it to their patients. And that's the part which is different than the financial incentive, and I totally agree with the technological imperative, but I find that to be a profound problem ethically. And I wonder how distinct what physicians think for themselves is from what they think through organized medicine.
Wow. I didn't know about the potassium chloride.
Well, this is only one friend of mine. I'm not saying it's gone.
Okay.
I'm not saying. Chloride to himself.
Yes. Anesthesiologist.
Well, among other things. Okay. They do a lot of drugs and things. And it used to be that there was a hot. That there was a high suicide rate among physicians. I don't know whether that's still true, but they have access to drugs that other people don't have access to. But what you're describing is a level of hypocrisy that I had not entertained before.
Good. Thank you so much. Marcia, that was wonderful.